Welcome to another edition, Market Hunter Thursday with Herve. So excited for you guys to be with us today. Let's go ahead and get started. Invite Lee into the show. Lee, good afternoon. Thanks very much for being with us today. Lee, you know, usually we just kind of jump into with our guest speakers and we talk about the type of investing that they're doing in their respective market. But man, you have a real interesting background. I went to your website. I was taking a look at it. You used to work for a Fortune 100 company dealing with a lot of big budgets. It was taking you around the world to some real interesting parts. You left when you're around 45 years old to start your own general consulting business. Tell us about that transition. It's a transition a lot of folks would like to make. They have difficulty making. What made you feel comfortable making that transition from corporate America to starting your own development company?
It wasn't a happenstance. So essentially, okay. I planned for this when I got in corporate. So when I got in corporate, within about 6 to 12 months, I realized that I didn't want to spend 40 years in corporate America. At that point, I really didn't enjoy it a whole lot. As time progressed, I actually began to enjoy the corporate gig. But it's not mine. So fundamentally for me, there was two things that kind of drove me to moving on. One, there's no legacy there. So when I left corporate, as much as I had done and as much as I accomplished, within about 12 months, I disappeared from the landscape of the company.
Okay.
That's number one. Number two is financial, but more so time freedom. The freedom to do what I want, when I want, how to do it. So
right.
I still work as many hours as I worked in corporate. I just can structure them the way I want to structure them. And when I wake up in the morning, typically I work a 14-hour day. But there are days I wake up and I go play golf and then I go sit down and hang out with friends. And that's part of my day. So I work just as many hours. It was just the freedom and then the ability to have a legacy and leave something to, I've got three kids, leave something to my three kids. So whatever I'm done here, I'm building, I hand over to them. And corporate is very different. You hand over to the next manager, next executive. So very different feeling, a very different process. I'm an engineer by degree. So figuring things out, building, dealing with tough problems and kind of working your way through things is kind of in my DNA. On the side, I had been doing rehabs and flips probably for about 10 years, even before I transitioned out of corporate into doing this full time.
Are you still active in flips? And if you're not active in flips, what part of the real estate segment are you very much active in?
I will do a flip here and there if the opportunity jumps out at me, but I'm not active doing flips. I moved from flips to doing custom homes. I started doing large custom homes, 10,000, 12,000 square feet. And I really don't do a lot of that anymore. So primarily what I do right now is a couple of things. I'm building my own portfolio of mostly small multifamily products. So I'm looking more or less for residual income more so than anything else at this point in time. Do a lot of consulting as well. I still build. It's just not the primary function of my business. And then I do development. So I buy portions of land, subdivide it. Like I've got one right now. I've got an acre lot. I'm subdivided into 18 different parcels. And I'm going to build what I would call a BTR, build to rent community. So I'm going to build 18 homes. I'm not going to sell them. I'm going to rent them primarily because I'm looking for residual income. Not for a quick hit. So I'm kind of in all segments of the market. It's just I'm kind of focusing on what I would call building my own portfolio and then helping others achieve their goals. And I don't do custom homes as much, primarily because it's so time consuming and it's such an emotional attachment to a custom home. So it just takes up a disproportionate amount of my time.
What is it about Houston that makes it attractive for small, mid-sized multifamily from what you've seen?
I primarily focus in Houston. I've got some things in other cities, Atlanta, Louisiana, but primarily my focus is here in Houston. So multifamily here in Houston is somewhat interesting because we don't have what's called traditional zoning like most cities. But that's only misnomer because the city can achieve zoning through other means other than just zoning. So we have a dearth of multifamily being built just because they put regulations in place over the last 10 years that really discourages small multifamily. They're really gearing toward the large 200 unit, 150 unit, 300 unit large multifamily is what they really want. And so the regulations have really driven out any new construction that's small multifamily. So there's a gap there. There's ways around those regulations legally. You just got to understand what the city's code really says and how to get around that. So my focus is in small multifamily because that's where I see a gap. And so if you ever looked in Houston, anything that is a double duplex, triplex, fourplex, sixplex, it's really overpriced because there's a lack of those. And then there's a significant demand for those. So anytime I talk to a new investor, the first thing they want to talk about is, I want to buy a triplex, I want to buy a quadplex and so forth. But everything out there is really overvalued based on what you're getting. You're getting a 30-year-old property. It's got problems. It's in an area that may not be the most ideal. And so I just took the stance that I'm not going to deal with it. I'm going to start from scratch. I'm going to find properties that I think are attractive, that I can put a triplex or I can put a fourplex and then build from the ground up. And so that's really been my strategy and philosophy, is building from the ground up versus buying some of the things out there that in my mind are not as attractive as some other cities at this point in time.
So how long has it been going on that, you know, you found out, you didn't find out, but I guess you had done some research and, you know, the connection that you had, say, hey, listen, you know what, it would get more beneficial if we went ahead and started just developing versus out there purchasing. Like you said, things have gotten expensive. That seems to be a case in a lot of large cities around the country. What were some of the factors that drove that?
Okay, I missed the last part, but I think I got the gist of your question. I've got a competitive advantage that quite frankly, a lot of people don't have. I'm a builder, I'm a developer, and so the cost you would pay folks to do what I do, I don't pay myself. So I've got a competitive advantage built in when it comes to development and multifamily. But the big thing, well, I guess everywhere, is cap rate. Looking at, if I'm going to buy a duplex, if I'm going to buy a multifamily, then how is it going to cash flow? And then how is it going to appreciate going forward? And so I just did the numbers. I'm an analytical type person, and it just didn't sit well with me. Some of the deals that people were picking up, they just take too long to cash flow. They take too long to appreciate. Didn't make sense for me. And so I just looked at the market and said, where is my niche? Where can I get in and add significant value for my own company? That's where it was, multifamily. I mean, I still do other things, but personally, multifamily is my favorite piece of business. For me, it's easy to develop, it's easy to build, and the numbers make sense now. So, you know, when I started this several years ago, made my primary strategy, land was actually pretty reasonably priced. Mm-hmm. And so add up the cost of land versus the cost to build, the better product, and I'm getting a less expensive product than if I go out and buy one that's already in place. Now, in the last 12, 18 months, what I've seen is a significant price in land prices here in Houston as well, especially on the low end. You know, low end, when I say low end, I mean, you know, picking up lots for $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, those lots have significantly jumped. Now, if you want to buy lots for, you know, $3-4 million, those lots are still available. But everybody doesn't have that kind of cash to jump in on a deal like that. And so I think in your initial segment, you mentioned $171,000 was the medium price for Houston. That's probably old data, because right now anything under $225,000,
wow,
we can't stop. I mean, it's just crazy. At the high end, we're struggling. But anything in that $300,000 and under, we can't keep inventory.
Are you guys as well outstretched on demand versus just supply of homes that folks are looking to, especially as you get here into the strong selling season?
So depends on what part of the market. If you're under 300,000, there's almost no supply. So
gotcha.
The inventory, we may have a couple months of inventory. Anything under 300,000, so that, which is basically no inventory. Yeah, we're definitely stretched for what we call affordable homes. Mm-hmm. Now, on the high end, we're fine. So if you want to buy a home for 1.5, 2 million, the kind of custom homes I build, yeah, there's plenty of inventory there and there's plenty of opportunity there if you want to be a builder. But if on the low end, there's no lots. So what I see people doing now, going further and further out. So Houston's a big city population wise, but it's also a big city land mass wise. And so the suburbs, places like Conroe, Katy are starting to boom. And those places are probably, you know, 30-40 minutes outside of what I would call downtown central Houston, because they've got cheaper land, they've got more affordable land. Because anything in the city is getting pricey and just priced most people out of the market, unless you bought it, you know, years ago. So that's what we're seeing. We've got the same problem that pretty much every other major city has, affordable housing.
Yeah,
and being able to build affordable housing, and then it just keeps going up. So Every 6 months it goes up in price, which means it's less affordable than it was previously. And then we've got a problem now. We've got lumber prices have gone through the roof.
Right.
Which is another problem around where we've got to jump prices $20,000, $30,000 per house. So it really doesn't classify as affordable anymore. But that's not a Houston problem.
That's a national problem. Yeah,
that's right.
Absolutely. We've heard that from other builders as well. You might have mentioned before, and if not, I apologize. When on some of your development, are you developing for sale and for rent, or just for rent on some of your small multifamilies?
That's a good question. So right now it's just for rent, but okay. I have a couple projects. I have a couple of things in the works that are going to build for sale. And so, because what I talked about earlier, I see a market where there's a significant demand for new investors that want to buy multifamily, but their options are limited. And so what I'm putting together now is, you know, a portfolio of lots where I can not only build for myself, but I can build actually to sell to investors. Because what I'm seeing is some of the things I have built for myself, I may put on the market just to get it tested.
Right.
And within a couple of days, I've got, you know, 6-7 people want to buy it at full price. So,
right.
I kind of looked at that and said, you know what, there's a market there for investors to get a better product at pretty much the same price point. And so it's a win-win for everyone.
Lee, with what you're seeing going on in Houston for the years that you've been there, do you see from a pricing perspective, right, things just getting out of control, harder to make your margin, harder to go ahead and surpass your break even? Do you see this being more cyclical? And if so, is the bubble going to be bursting in Houston anytime soon? Or is it more secular because there could be some new dynamics taking place in Houston, whether there's migration of population going on, that's certainly happening in other cities. A lot of headquarters of big companies, I mentioned some of them at the beginning of the show, even more jobs coming in. Do you see a little bit of it being a secular shift or something cyclical that perhaps may not be sustained?
I wish I knew the answer to that.
You did too.
I'd be a very wealthy man if I knew the answer to that. But I suspect it's not as cyclical as it has been in the past. See, Houston was an oil and gas market. And so when the oil and gas bust hit in the late 80s, then Houston took a beating. The oil and gas pretty much for the most part have busted over the last couple of years, and we've not taken as much of a beating because we're more diverse now. We've got a diversity of industries. Mm-hmm. We've got the largest medical center in the world.
Right.
And that drives a lot of income, not only just the medical center, but the research arms associated with those. And then we have other companies moving here that have nothing to do with oil and gas, HP, Cisco. I mean, there's a bunch of companies here that makes Houston pretty diverse. And so our net inflows is significant every year. So we don't have what we call net outflows.
Right.
I don't see that. We've got a huge shipping industry here. We've got the Port of Houston.
Right.
We've got the space stations coming. I mean, so we've got so many things in Houston that I don't see Houston going into a cyclical downspin so deep that we can't dig ourselves out. Everything's cyclical, so we're going to have ups and downs.
But
I think strategically speaking, Houston is a good market to be in. And I don't see anything that's going to bring us down long term. So yeah, we're going to have the dips. But long term, and I've been here since 91, I wish I could go back and buy stuff that I saw, you know, 20 years ago.
Say that, man. If I knew back then what I know today, I would have just invested a little bit more. Right.
So
we're retired in the Caribbean right now. I hear you.
Absolutely. So Hawaii for me, but yeah.
Well, Hawaii, there you go, that too.
So I am actually diversifying. I'm looking to diversify outside of Houston because I've got so many holdings in Houston, but I'm never going to abandon Houston as my core. I'm going to continue to expand here. But I am looking at other markets that I see growing that I think I'm going to dip my toe into as we speak.
Gotcha. Talking about markets, but instead of, we'll stick to Houston. You mentioned some of the cities before. If you could dive in a little bit, especially for folks like myself, other folks that are listening in that are not from Houston, when you start talking about the secondary, tertiary markets of Houston, where there could potentially be some opportunities because pricing hasn't run away in those areas as it has in Houston, per se. What can you explain to us a little bit, which are some of those markets, and are they benefiting from the strength in the Houston economy? Like you're saying, medical center, some tech companies, and so on and so forth, moving into Houston.
So Houston is, Houston has three loops. I mean, we've got three. So the inner loop is pretty much saturated unless you're going to gentrify certain areas. So there's certain areas right now that are being gentrified, but I won't talk about that right now. So we've got a third loop coming in Houston. And so what I've seen is, which is pretty far out, it's probably 35, 40 miles outside the center of Houston. But there's a lot of activity there because there's a lot of vacant land. And now you've got a third loop being developed. So it gives people access to other freeways. So some of the areas are Katy. There's 99, Tollway 99 going through Katy, Conroe. These are areas that are seeing explosive growth in housing for a couple of reasons, primarily because they've now got access via a large highway. They've got affordable land. And it begin to develop the infrastructure and amenities that you see in other places in Houston. Well, Katy's pretty much developed, but Conroe is pretty much a new phenomenon within Houston. They got proximity to the airport. So are there opportunities there? Yes, but they're not what I would call hidden opportunities. Everybody knows they're there.
Right.
So you kind of got to fight with everybody else to get the prime land and so forth. I kind of look for what I would call hidden gems, or areas that are on the cusp of gentrification, or areas that just what I would consider undervalued based on what may be coming down the pipeline that may be public knowledge, but they may not be widely known. So new highways coming in, new facilities being built, new company putting a warehouse in a certain area. So I kind of look for things that are coming in 1 or 2 years and then try to jump in front of it to get there before the crowd comes. Once the crowd comes, then
it's too late. Herd mentality has taken over. It's taken over.
Right.
Man, listen, you know, we talk about gentrification. We won't go deep into it, but we've all seen the signs of it. When you see, you know, your Whole Foods and Trader Joe's and some kind of Asian fusion restaurant thing going on, you know, it really starts as like, uh-oh, there's something going on around here. Because you know that those companies, they do their homework as to where are we going to put our stores, our supermarkets, our malls based on the median income beginning to rise into this particular city. And they don't need to be first mover into that particular city. They could just as well wait, see how the transformation comes through, bigger companies come through, and then they'll go ahead and follow suit. And then you see the developers and the building and the flipping and the land and so on and so forth. So we've seen it in many markets, and it seems like Houston's really no different.
Oh, no, no. When Whole Foods is really the telltale sign. When Whole Foods hits the market,
that's it. It's over. It's a wrap. It's too late. It's really too late. Yeah, Whole Foods is like, oh, man, you just start shaking your head. You feel like sometimes you feel like the way I feel when I see a Whole Foods comes in, especially if it's, you know, neighborhood that I grew up in, I'm like, there goes the neighborhood, man. It's just like I lose a part of my culture, They just don't know how they're wrecking it for us.
It's a double-edged sword because you need those amenities and services in those communities.
Yes.
The challenge is once they come to those communities, then the prices tend to go up, and then you kind of price out the folks that would normally reside in those communities. So, you know, we've got the same thing here. Whole Foods is definitely the telltale sign. And when I see them,
It seems like the Whole Foods' best years are ahead of it, all this gentrification going on around the country.
Oh, yeah. They're putting smaller stores in these areas.
Yes.
And so they've really got smart about it. And I think they're at the point now where they can almost make a market. So, you know, they can afford to be first in now. And then once they jump in, everyone else kind of jumps in around them.
They got the brand name.
They're Amazon. So Amazon's figured out a lot of things.
Yes, they have. Yeah. And they'll continue to. That's for sure. One of the things we like to do is always give our guest speakers, as we near the end of the show, an opportunity to really talk about what we can do and how we can help you out. Because you certainly, with LH53, is helping out a lot of folks. If you can talk about that and potentially how we at DeRosa Group and our listeners can help you out and what you're doing at LH53.
Yeah, I don't know how to answer that question. I'm at the point in my journey where I'm actually looking to help others. So I've been blessed. I've done well. I've got a good path in front of me. And so I'm looking to help others, and I'm particularly looking to help others, how do I say this, that have been left out of the process. So when I'm there's a lack of female participation in construction. There's a lack of minority participation in construction. So I've made it my mission to try to be a source for those who have nowhere else to go to get information. So really, that's really what I've been doing. So on the side, I actually do a class for newbies to kind of just get them an introduction into the business, the do's, the don'ts, so they've got a good footing on the ground. So as far as what can be done for me, I don't know how to answer that. I guess I'm just a resource, but as far as what you can do for me, I don't know how to answer that.
Hey, but listen, man, at the end of the day, you're paying it forward, right? I mean, and you realize, like you said, there's a lot of folks that haven't been able to participate. And some of the things that we were talking about today, it's happening in their own backyards. And if it's happening in their own backyards, you know, they were born there, they were raised there, they've gone to school there. You like to see them participate in a lot of the changes and then improvements that are taking place in their own community. And, you know, and so if they can use you as a source, a resource for someone who's done it, excelled at it, and, you know, proof of concept, then, hey, man, God bless, and really keep great things going for them, because, you know, we need more Lee Hamptons out there, not only in Houston, but all over, that recognize, hey, listen, there's a void out there. Let's see what we can do to kind of help empower those that have been left behind. So, you know, day by day, brick by brick, we got to do our part. Folks, thanks very much for listening today. Hope you got a lot of information in regards to what's going on in Houston. Seems like there's some opportunities, but you got to pick your spots. Perhaps take a look at some of those neighborhoods, some of those markets, 20, 30, 40 minutes outside of Houston, where there's still some reasonable activity going on, reasonable pricing going on, that's being aided and supported by development on the highways, stores, Whole Foods, and things like that. So pick your spots in Houston and exactly how you're going to approach your real estate investment strategy in Houston. But again, you may want to start in some of those secondary and tertiary markets where you have better opportunity for return. So listen, I want to thank everyone again for dialing in for another episode of Market Hunter Thursday with Herve. Again, if you like what you see, please hit that subscribe button at the bottom of your screen. And I wish you a healthy, profitable week, and we will see you next week. We hold on. Everyone, take care.